आप सभी का ट्रैवलो स्थान के इंडिया देखो सीरीज के 12th पार्ट में स्वागत है। इंडिया इज द लैंड ऑफ मेनी कल्चर्स, इंडिया हैज अ वैरायटी ऑफ कल्चर्स, इंडिया इज डिस्टिंक्ट इन कल्चर फूड एवरीथिंग, बट देयर इज अन एस्पेक्ट वेयर सीन एंड वेयर इंडिया इज आल्सो रिच, दैट इज द इट्स जियोग्राफी इट्स नेचर। सो जियो हेरिटेज वीक व्हिच वी आर we started on 21st of 21st and would continue till next Tuesday. We are celebrating Geo Heritage Week. Under this week, today we are very glad to have 5 participants with us, starting from the senior most professor till the research, and it is a pleasure to host everybody. So coming on to the today we'll take on Tuesday we took you on the journey. We told you about the details of geoheritage and the aspects of geoheritage and technique. Now today we'll talk about the geoheritage tourism and we'll take you to different sites, various sites of geoheritage, starting from Rajasthan, Gujarat, then coming to the Shivalik belt of Punjab, Himachal, and then we have people with Gujarat. So I'd like to call upon our first speaker. It is a very glad to him. This is a father-son duo, father or son ka jodi hai, and we welcome both of them, Professor S.C. Mathur and Saurav Mathur. Talking about Professor S.C. Professor S.C. Mathur is former professor and head department of geology, JNV University, Jodhpur. He has extensively worked on different aspects of sedimentology, paleontology, and planetary sciences. And Barmer Basins of India and published many papers in international journals. He organized several international and national conferences and field workshops and represent India in about 40 countries abroad. Since last 7 years, he is actively engaged in promotion of geoheritage through his research articles and establishing methodology to select and assess the significant geosites in India for their conservation, and also by organizing various outreach programs on geoheritage. This is about Professor S.C. Mathur and his son, Mr. I'll tell about him. He is a research pursuing PhD in on geoheritage and promotion of geoheritage tourism in Western Rajasthan from Suresh Ganwar University, Jaipur. And it is very that at this age he has visited 6 countries and had a glimpse of the geoheritage sites and the geoparks of those countries. I welcome Professor S.C. Mathur and
thank you, Vinyan. It is great pleasure for me to once again join you for the promotional activities and awareness program regarding geoheritage. Earlier on 21st July this year, we have been associated with you on the geoheritage day, and now in continuation with this geoheritage theme, today we are joined today to deliver lecture on wonders of geoscience of Marwar, Western Rajasthan, India. The Western Rajasthan, you know that it is known for Thar Desert, Indian Thar Desert, and the geomorphological features of Thar Desert fascinating the tourists, and lot of tourists are coming, and one of the geosites you can see here, the some Thar Desert. And geologically, the Marwar region is also endowed with the very significant rock.
Saurav?
Yes?
Saurav, aapki presentation nahi aa raha sir. आपका सर प्रेजेंटेशन नहीं दिख रहा है।
प्रेजेंटेशन अप्रूव कर दिया ना? अब इज इट ओके?
नहीं दिख नहीं रहा है मेरे को तो उधर।
क्यों? सर दिख नहीं रहा है।
वो किसी शर्मा ने प्रेजेंट की थी स्क्रीन।
अंजलि शर्मा को स्क्रीन शेयर कर रही हूँ उनको ब्लॉक की।
अंजलि शर्मा एंड सोना शर्मा प्लीज स्टॉप प्रेजेंटिंग।
सोनल शर्मा
Yes.
It's a request to everybody that apart from the panelists, don't screen, share your screen.
Okay, now it is visible?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So, geologically, Western Rasam and Marmar area is very significant as it is endowed with the significant rocks of the igneous rocks of Malani igneous suit of rocks as a basement and the younger rocks sedimentary basins, namely Marwar, Barmer and Jaisalmer basin. So these constitute the regional geology and they are endowed with very significant geoheritage sites within this Marwar region. And today I am going to highlight one point that Marwar region is also significantly endowed with the geo-monumental structures which have been constructed by the heritage stones. For example, Mahalgarh Fort, which is constructed by heritage stone known as the Jodhpur Sandstone or Chittar Ka Patthar, and the Jaswan Palace, it is constructed by the marble of the Railo group of Delhi, super group. Similarly, the Umed Palace by the Jodhpur Sandstone, and many temples and the carving in these temples and many handicraft items, all these. So, it's actually
स्क्रीन लोगों को देख रहे वापस एक बार चालू करें ठीक है
ओके ओके थैंक यू ओके सो दीज जियोमॉन्यूमेंटल स्ट्रक्चर्स गिव द एडिशनल वैल्यूज टू आवर जियो हेरिटेज इन द मारवाड़ रीजन दैट आई विल शो यू एंड हाईलाइट इन माय डेलिब्रेशन सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल व्हाट इज जियो साइट जियो साइट इज एसेंशियली अ लोकेलिटी आउटक्रॉप लैंडस्केप लैंडफॉर्म्स और एन एरिया व्हिच इज एंडोर्ड विद इंपॉर्टेंट जियो रिसोर्सेज Geo resources means minerals, rocks and fossils. In any hilly terrain around us, we have either the minerals, rocks or fossils. They are the geo resources. And India is significantly endowed with a wide variety of geo resources from Archean to recent sediments. And among these geo resources, we have to identify some significant geo sites. Which shows the geodiversity of regional, national and international significance, imparting knowledge of the Earth history. This is the main thing. It should provide the Earth history of a particular period or the time. For example, I have taken the example of Bada Bagh section of Jaisalmer group from Jaisalmer area. It has a regional significance because it is endowed with the cenotaphs which have been constructed by the heritage stone of Jaisalmer limestone. It also provides the Bada Bagh section sedimentary rocks having a wide variety of fossils there, one water body and the sand dunes. So one particular site has some geodiversity elements. Similarly, some geosite having the geomorphological features, various type of geomorphological features of the Thar Desert. It may be Parakan, longitudinal dunes, and many tourists are attracting because of these geomorphologies there at some. So it has some values, that is the national values. And similarly, third one is the outcrop at the Mahalgarh Ridge at Jodhpur. It is endowed with the thick section of the pyroclastics of the Malani igneous suit. We know that the Malani igneous suit is internationally very significant because it is one of the largest acidic terrestrial volcanism of the world. And it is affiliated to Pan-African orogeny. And it is also related to the split of the Rodinia supercontinent at that time. And due to this magmatism, there is has been a development of the oldest sea, that is called as Ediacara Sea, in which the Jodhpur of rocks have been deposited. And this interface is also there at the same Mehrangarh ridge. It is demarcated by a non-conformity or unconformity between Cryogenian period and the Ediacara period. Nowhere you will find that such type of interface. So we have the land and marine interaction on a one single outcrop, and GSI has declared both the outcrop as National Geological Monument. Along with its features, the columnar joints, the rhyolite and pyroclastics, and the Jodhpur rock is endowed with the wide variety of the fossils. These fossils are called as Ediacara fossil, and we have the treasure of sedimentary structure in form of different type of structure. They all imparting the paleo environment, paleogeographic conditions, and evolution of the life from non-skeleton to skeleton, means before the radiation event. So one particular geosite imparting a knowledge of regarding Earth's history of two significant periods, Cryogenian and Ediacara. Saurabh Mathur will explain you about these features later on. So, in Indian context, how we can identify and characterize and describe our geosites is very important, because we don't have any methodology before our paper, which is published in the Scopus Journal of Journal of Tourism and Geosite in 2020. And before that, we have discovered a very significant outcrop in the Barmer city of Barmer region, where we have discovered the very rare and unique fossil assemblage of mayfly.
It's a request to everybody that please don't present your screen apart from the panelist.
So somebody is sharing our screen, that's why this problem is happening. Okay. So regarding the methodology to identify the geosites and the fossil park in India, we have proposed a methodology from a very significant outcrop at the Barmer city, which we also proposed for the fossil park, national fossil park there, on the outcrops of the very rare and significant fossils of the mayfly. And it is the only deposit in India and sixth in the world. So, regarding the methodology, at any geosite, if you want to select or the study or characterize, previous work is very important. What type of previous data we have and should integrate with our present work, that is vigorous field work, petrographic work, geochemical, paleontological and remote sensing data, all should integrate with the previous work, and you should identify and characterize the geo resources of a particular area. And among these geo resources, after the characterization, we have to identify the significant geosite. And after selection and assess the geosite, we should plan for their protection and the conservation. And it should be a identified geosite, National Fossil Park with IPA or Paleo Park tag. So all these geosites and fossil park sites should have or work as an outdoor field museum for the education for the students, researchers, and significant features. So they should tell about how this geosite or the outcrop is evaluated for the educational purposes, and each site should have the geotourism elements also. If we club all these features, it will provide us the socio-economic development of a region through the GPAR. So if you combine 2, 4 or five or many geosites together, having the different geodiversity characters, it will be a unified area of the geopark. So additionally, in Indian context, I would like to highlight that many of the geosites are associated with the certain monumental structure and the buildings. For example, on the Malani, the suit of rocks, there is an imposing Mehrangarh Fort, which is constructed by the Helpi Jodhpur sandstone. Similarly, the Jaswant Palace, which is constructed by the marble. So, these two monumental structures can be an additional value to the particular geosite of the Malani Basin. Similarly, any water body, either it is natural, traditional, or a large or small body, but it is associated with the our geosite surrounding rocks and their features. Similarly, Umaid Palace, which is also constructed by Jodhpur sandstone, is and the rocks of the Jodhpur Brook here, and a water body. So all can combine. Similarly, the outcrop of the Malani Igneous Suit overlain by the Jodhpur Brook, and we have the rampart of the fort and its very famous Chamunda Mata temple. So these monumental geoheritage can be an additional tool to promote the geotourism. So based on these international code of conduct, Indian geosites can be of five types, taking example from the Marwar. I have taken the example from the Marwar, and they are mainly the geological, geomorphological, hydrogeological, historical and cultural, and fifth one is the archaeological. So Saurabh Mathur will explain you one by one all the type of the geoheritage present in the Marwar region. Saurabh Mathur, please.
Good evening, everybody. Continuing with the presentation, I would first like to describe that what actually you mean by the word geological type geosite. It is actually defined as a range or diversity of geological bedrock, geomorphological landform, and their significant features, which include the evidences of the past life, ecosystem, and environment in the history of Earth, as well as a range of atmospheric, hydrogeological, and biological processes. This definition can be best understood by taking the example of Mehrangarh Ridge in the Jodhpur city, which comprises of two significant geological formations. The first one is the Malani Igneous Suit of Rocks, and the second one is Jodhpur Group of Rocks. The Malani Igneous Suit of Rocks is very significant within itself because it is the world's largest terrestrial acidic volcanic activity. It represents various geologic features in the Jodhpur city on the Mehrangarh Ridge, that is eutectic fault, volcanic breccia, core stone columnar joints, and rhyolite. Now talking of the Jodhpur Group of Rocks, Jodhpur Group of Rocks display very significant Ediacara fossils. Ediacara period is very significant because it represents the primitive life forms on the Earth. After the splitting of Rodinia supercontinent, there was occurrence of Ediacara sea, and the fossils of organisms in that sea are known as Ediacara fossils. We also have unconformity between Cryogenian and Ediacaran period, which are two significant periods of the Earth's history, and this is a non-conformity. Recently in 2001, this unconformity and the columnar joints in pyroclasts, these have been declared as National Geological Monuments by GSI. You can also see that the Jodhpur Group of Rocks display various sedimentary textbook, I would rather use the word textbook style sedimentary structures. The rocks have the imprint marks, cross bedding, graded bedding, ripples. You can see ripples of varied types. So the Jodhpur group of rocks are rather the
different sea.
So Western Rajasthan is also endowed with significant geomorphological type geoheritage. These are Ajmer Valley and monuments, famous Anasagarnese cone, sand dunes of the Thar Desert. You can see that the sand dunes are the major attraction of tourists nowadays, and these Ajmer Valley and Anasagar are have their Aravalli Valley fold belt in their vicinity. Jodhpur group of Western Rajasthan is also endowed with many erosional landforms, but I would discuss only three of them. The first one is Core Stone in Mahalli Pyroclastics, which is located on the Mehrangarh Ridge and is essentially formed by the erosion and bedding processes in Malani near Super Frogs. The second one is the Pushkar pedestal rocks in Pokhran Sandstone, and the third one is the Elephant Mark in Barbrenai. The Jodhpur group of rocks is also endowed with significant hydrogeological sites. These hydrogeological sites can be categorized into three categories. The first one is natural water body, large natural water bodies. These are Devkund, Balchandak Lake, Umed Sagar Lake. The second category is the small, large traditional water bodies. These are Lal Sagar Lake, Gulab Sagar Pond, and Padamsar Pond. These water bodies are formed by human interaction, or we can say human intervention. The third category is small groundwater bodies that depict the that represents the rich groundwater knowledge of our ancestors. Now coming to the historical and cultural geosites, these are Mehrangarh Fort, which is associated with Malani near Super Frogs. Second one is Umedbhawan Palace, associated with Jodhpur group of rocks. Third one is the sandstone mine, which can also contribute to Almond geotourism. Third one is the Piradu Temple, Barmer. Fourth member, Sonar Fort, Jaisalmer. Buldara member and Mountain Group, Jaisalmer. Ajmer Valley, having the oldest Aravalli Valley fort built in vicinity, Pushkar Valley and Lake, and the last one is Delhi Kotsari and Talamar Fort. Western Rajasthan is also endowed with significant archaeological geosites. These are Delhi Kotsari, Buddha Pushkar dunes and lakes, Paleolithic artifacts and tools of 2000 to 4000 years. Gadiyala inscription of 861 CE found at Mundur Fort, 22.5 to 37.4 kilo years quaternary section of Pidja Fatehpur Sherpur. The last one is Lower Paleolithic Artifact site of Bimana section. So, hello. So recently, the Mehrangarh Museum Trust in the Jodhpur city have developed a famous Rabzuda Desert Rock Park on the Mehrangarh Ridge, which consists of heritage structures, heritage water body, heritage palaces, educational sites, tourism sites, adventurous sites, national geological monuments, fossils, cultural sites, and which all together can be a geopark site.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor A.C. Mathuran, Saurabh, for such a wonderful presentation on Western Rajasthan. I would like to thank both of you and like to say that thing, one thing, that we are getting questions and requests from many of the students who are there in this. Many students are there with us, so it's a glad opportunity for us. Punyakriti Ranawat, please stop sharing your screen, otherwise we'll block you. It's a request to everybody that please don't share your screen until unless we see you.
About question answer, we have done.
Sir, coming on to the next speaker, it's a pleasure to host former dean and former professor MLSU Molna Chukadi University. Hello. Sir, please share the screen. Molna Chukadi University. He is Professor Pushpinder Singh Ranawat. He is basically born and brought up in Udaipur, and we are glad to have associated with us. 74th year professor. Welcome, sir, on board. And talking about Professor Ranawat, he is founding member of INTAC Udaipur chapter, and he is working for promotion of various geo-heritage sites near Udaipur range, and he is also working for promotion of geo-heritage park in Zarwar belt, and he is working for Ramgarh Meteoritic Impact Crater belt in Jaipur. It's a pleasure to host you, Professor Ranawat. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everybody. I hope you can hear me. Is it okay, sound?
Sir, we can hear you. Your screen is visible.
Screen is visible? Okay. So, it's a great pleasure sharing my information, some of the things of Udaipur area. As you are aware, I'll be taking up Udaipur division, the Mewar kingdom of the past. So Rajasthan is the westernmost state of Indian Union, and in its southern part we have the state of Mewar, constituting some what is presently Udaipur division, comprising few districts of the southern Rajasthan. So we are already familiar with most of the things, but what is really unfortunate that we have several international world heritage sites. They are all cultural heritage sites, natural heritage, the spatially biotic nature, the geologic aspects are absolutely missing. Even at present, there are 161 global geoparks in the world, but India has none. What we have are just 34 or 32 national geological monuments, of which 10 are located in Rajasthan. That way we are somewhat lucky, and we are promoting two additional geoheritage sites or national geological monuments at the moment. So through INTAC we have proposed more that this information should percolate down to public, a layman, man in the street. They should be familiar with all these aspects. So all these 10 presently identified sites have been mapped on the district map, and their small description has been given, and a very precise description of each of the 10 that are there. They have been given, and two we are promoting. One is Zawar and another is Ramgarh. They have been also added to it. Hopefully, Government of India will accept these two in due course of time. So, although because of the publicity, Wikipedia has already included 33 and 34 as national geological monument or geo heritage sites of India. So we are happy about it, but we'll be happier if government. Now coming to the main aspect, I'll be taking up the geo-heritage sites of Udaipur division. In this first, I'll take up Udaipur city itself, then Jamar Kotra Astrometalite Fossil Park, then Aujunda Astrometalite Park and Zawar, and one site of Ramgarh. So we receive large number of tourists in Udaipur. Udaipur is already well established tourist center, but everybody doesn't want to go to the field. So what we are proposing to the museum in Udaipur, and then the city project to develop all the main fossil park present in the within Udaipur. We receive at least 22 university students every year. So we are also sort of a geo-tourist only. And still not arranged. And we are all... So... We... Still... So the first thing of interest is the Jamar Kotra National Geological Monument. Its importance is because it shows that there was life in our system or regime 1800 million years back. That is Arabi system. There was controversy even in Indian. But suddenly we have life in Arabi. So it was an international phenomena, and people from Germany, Russia, whole of India gathered, discovered it was made in 1968, but in 1978 it was declared as a national geological monument. So what we have here are these colonies of stromatolite, the algal fossil that are growing at perpendicular to the bedding of limestone there, and along we are developing what are we call satellites. Colonists are familiar with these things. Every lay tourists will not be interested in visiting this thing. Therefore, more popular or public interest aspects should be there. So what we are doing is, there is a Baghdara Nature Park. So visit Baghdara Nature Park, and there is Jawar Jameshwar Game Temple area with stalactite, stalactite statue, Devani, sacred food, water and everything. So it's nice to take an outing spot. Baghdara is also a crocodile lake and wildlife sanctuary, South Pateng. And nearby village is also there. There is a 10th century temple. So this, all these have been combined together to make this Jamar Kotra a tourist target. This is a proposal we have already submitted to Tourist Reception Center Udaipur of the state government, and they have forwarded it to the director for further development and development aspects. I'll skip these things, this is a technical aspect. Another good National Geological Monument that is declared is of the Bogunda near Chittorgarh. Now it has become also part of Chittorgarh. So I think it should be renamed as the Chittorgarh National Geological Monument. Of these are stromatolite or life within Arabi system, younger rock, 900 million year old rock. But it is very well located. There is a national highway, you can see in the lower left corner slide. National highway coming from Ajmer and national highway going to Koka. They meet at the point, and very near to it, on the right side, you'll see an about 3 acre plot that is still lively. Behind it is the Sarat milk factory. So we have also collected to earmark and protect this as a National Geological Monument, where a small interpretation center can be built. Signages will be put up, and folders that I showed you earlier of a specific location will be distributed to interested people. This is of interest because Fraud Court and Nagri are already there. Now we come to a next most important thing is the Zawar area. Unfortunately, government has not yet declared it as a National Geological Heritage Site. There are several issues based on that, but we are after it, and because Foreign British Museum London and American Society of Metals have already declared it as the world's first zinc smelting site in the world. And American Society of Metals in 1988, they went to the extent of attributing the Industrial Revolution of Europe to the zinc that was obtained from this place. So it has a global presence. So this area is well located. It is just 40 kilometers south of Udaipur. Udaipur is well connected from the world, airways, railways, roadways, and everything are there. And from there, an interested person can visit Zawar. This is a tech. These are the salient features of Zawar Global Geopark that we are promoting. This is the first zinc melting site in the world. More than 2,500-year-old underground mining and smelting, multi-metal smelting, mind you. And it has rich historical elements right from 646 CE. There are stone inscriptions describing the history of importance of this area. There are architectural aspects and several issues are there. And it is very popular even among students and other people. What we suggest is that instead of presently we have what are known as National Geological Monuments. These are like single plastics. Just say Sandra Granite or Nepheline Cyanide. They have Barcombo Parade. They have one aspect only. But Zawar or Ramgarh, they have multi-heritage aspects, both cultural as well as natural, biotech as well as abiotech. So a complete bouquet of flowers is there rather than a single stick. So this we have marked on a map, what are the sites of interest and how a tourist will go about locating it. Natural Heritage Division of INTAC has prepared a detailed map of a plot of an about 16 square kilometers on 1:8,000 map and grid of 200 meters by 200 meters. And a circuit has been prepared of how a tourist will proceed from here. So there are ancient temples which were destroyed during war time, but luckily, statues or idols were destroyed, but not the rock inscription. So the rock inscriptions are aplenty, and a full PhD has been produced recently, and they tell us of the history of this area. So there's no point going into geological aspect, but on the field visit, one can see ancient mining, open cast mining, even underground mining can be approached through certain tracking. Then there are very large number of hillocks or mounds of discarded material. That tells us what is the quantum of mining and smelting that was done. There is already a memoir of the GSI by Stradjack and Srikanthan in 1966 where they have estimated what is the quantity of material that must have been mined here. And all the details of ancient smelting is present there. Then there is an ancient fort is there, a gravity masonry dam is there, ancient Jain temples are there, Vaishnav temples are there. So what we propose is right from Zawar, there is a very good 1497 built step well, we call it Ramanath Kund, and a temple. So a tourist coming here, there will be a parking space of about 3 acres. Again, with interpretation center, refreshment room, and everything. land acquisition and all the formalities that GSI wanted has been completed. Earlier, GSI was declaring NGM without these things, but now they have got into a lot of routines. So this is the itinerary that we have proposed, right from Ramana temple down to what all places a person can visit these places. And again, as I told you, we are promoting not single destination, but multiple destination or satellite sites are also there. So person in the lower left slide, you'll see a person starting north from Udaipur will visit Zawar, visit Chavan Marana, the Cubs final capital. Then Jaisalmer, a very large lake with a game sanctuary, and return to Udaipur. So complete circuit is there. This is in the center, you will find YouTube URL. We have uploaded a 16, about 17 minute film of this tour circuit that one can visit and see. And finally, this last slide, although this doesn't come under Udaipur region, but intact Udaipur chapter is sort of a mentor in developing it. So this is a Rampart crater. Fortunately, this year only it has been approved as the one of the 200 terrestrial impact crater and third in India. And this is the only location in Rajasthan. So Hadoti sector tourism circuit, we have approved government that this should be developed, and what all things can be done that has been proposed and report has been prepared and it will be submitted to the government. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ranawat, for sharing such a wonderful information about the Mewar belt. It was till date we knew about the Lonar crater in Maharashtra, but we know about the Ramgarh crater also there is in our Rajasthan. So it's fortunate to have with us, and thank you for giving us your time.
It's my pleasure.
So, coming on to our next panelist, from Rajasthan, we'll take you to the eastern coast of India, that is to the Odisha belt. We have a very well-known archaeologist with us, Mr. Jitu Mishra from Odisha. Mr. Jitu Mishra is an MA in archaeology from Deccan College, Pune, and he is working in the areas of history, culture and heritage studies. He is also into the education sector and education, heritage and culture tourism. I welcome Mr. Jitu Mishra on board. Jitu sir, please unmute yourself.
Hi, good evening everyone. Can I start?
Yeah, please start.
I'll start with a slide. I think you are going to present the slides, no?
Okay. Meanwhile, you just start the introduction. I'll just share the slide.
Okay, thank you so much. I come from the eastern part of India and Odisha, and I'm going to talk about geographical diversity in Odisha. And I don't know many of you would know about it. So it's an eastern state surrounded by, covered with dense forest and mountains of the eastern Ghat and Chotanag plateau. You have many perennial rivers. 33% of Odisha has got wetlands. So you have different kind of lakes, lagoons, rivers. So these are aspects of Odisha, and I'll also tell you something like when it comes to the geo-heritage. Odisha has the oldest geological rock in the whole of world after Australia, which I'll be presenting in this slide, in these presentations. So let Gunjan ji start showing the presentation. So I think it's more of a pictorial journey. I don't think so I'll be able to talk much about the academic side like Sir said told, but I'll be taking through mostly a remote journey. Hello. Yeah. So you can see this is the Google satellite map of Odisha. where you have like Chotanagpur Plateau on the north, then you have the coastline, then you have Eastern Gondwana, Eastern Ghats, and Gondwana is one of the oldest formations, not as old as Aravali, but it is also one of the oldest formations, and it's named after the Gond tribe, which is found in the central part of India. Then you have the Central Highland, you have the Chilika Lake, which is the largest brackish water. So this is how Odisha looks, and when it is compared with Rajasthan, it's very, very different. It's more green, and Rajasthan is more, it has arid and semi-arid features. Here you have more of tropical features. So that's the contrast you see in the other part of India. So, the next slide, please. So this is North Coastal Plains. You have such majestic rivers, you know, closer to Bengal border, and you have lush green. Then you will find all the times activities like fishing and deep sea fishing takes place. And you have huge farmlands, mostly rice. Then you have beetle gardens. You have beetle leaf gardens. Then you have jute. So there are so many types, and fish is the main economy. Fishing is the main economy here, apart from agriculture. So this is about, and you must be knowing about the Chandipur beach I will be talking about, Chandipur on sea, which is the only of its kind beach in the country, where the sea reaches almost 5 kilometers every day during the ebb tide. So you can actually, when you get up in the morning, if it is a low tide, and then you can actually play cricket, you can drive your bike, you can do whatever you want. And when it comes afternoon, you'll see that the whole area where you were enjoying, you were having fun, you know, you were having so many activities, is now covered with water. So they are the sea waves. So this is what is the magical beach you have at Chandipur. And it's one of the most stunning sea beaches in the country, whole of country. And it's also the missile testing center. All of our India's major, you know, the prominent missiles like Agni and Prithvi, all of them. So there is, they are actually, this is the launching station. So this is also from the defense point of view, it's very strategically located. So next slide, please. Then you have varieties of marine species, especially the ghost crabs, which you find in hundreds and thousands of numbers. And they are all crawling on the water, on the beach, getting, when you approach them, they just squeeze themselves into the holes. And they are among the first crawling species. So you have thousands and millions of these red crabs and also golden crabs in the whole of North Odisha coast. Yeah, next. Now you must be knowing about Amazon in South America, and India, if you see a comparison, then probably the Bhitarkanika National Park is referred to as mini Amazon, where you find the all species of mangrove species. Besides, you have some of the largest crocodiles in the world. You find the Estuarian crocodiles. Some of them go up to 20-22 feet. And this Bhitarkanika also has a rare, white crocodile. So this is how, you know, there are so many creeks, and you have varieties of animals. You have seven, all the species of kingfishers. You have migratory birds. You have resident birds. It's a paradise for travelers who love actually nature and wildlife. So this is a paradise. Next slide, please. So you can see, you know, the mud banks, and you'll find crocodiles, then these birds, and it's like there is an eerie silence, and it's a biodiversity hotspot. So Bhitarkanika is like one of the most spectacular natural sites in the whole of Odisha. It was supposed to be declared as a World Heritage Site, but somehow it was rejected for some reasons, so it could not become a World Heritage Site. But still, it's a Ramsar site. So this is how Bhitarkanika is very well known. Then you have the Mahanadi Delta. So all the rivers in the country, major rivers of the country, they flow east, from west to east, except Narmada and Tapi. Otherwise, you know, whether it is Ganga, Yamuna, or your Mahanadi, then Godavari, Krishna, all of them flow from west to east. And Mahanadi, before it enters to the sea, forms the largest, one of the largest delta. And you have so these are various kind of, you know, the coastal communities, farming communities, you have rich heritage. So it's a very dynamic landscape. It keeps changing, you know, during the flood seasons, it keeps changing the river ships, the courses. And recently, you know, in Mahanadi, one of the 800-year-old temple was discovered, which had actually made a national census one. So that was discovered through intact. So that is how Mahanadi is known. Then you have so many lakes, freshwater lakes. You have in Mahanadi, in the Mahanadi Delta regions. And these lakes are freshwaters and they are paradise for tourists. You will find varieties of activities. You can spend here days and days there just doing nothing. And then you can go on boat ride, then you can enjoy the fishing activities. And you know, and there are so many amazing coastal communities you will be getting chance to interact with them. So this is how it is on Super Lake. Next slide, please. Then you have another river, one of the branches, one of the tributaries of Mahanadi, which is called Devi River. You have a very fascinating land there. You know, it's a wide expansion of water before it meets the sea. And you will find, you know, migratory birds, resident birds, then varieties of crabs, and then all kind of sea species. There are varieties of fishing practices. Then you have so many aspects. And the sunrise and sunsets are spectacular. So this is how is the Devi River now, which you again find is part of Mahanadi Delta. Yeah, you can see such kind of, you know, creeks and crabs. You will find all around the coast of Mahanadi. Then comes to the Chilka Lake, which is the largest brackish water lagoon in the whole of Asia, where you have Irrawaddy dolphins you know, there are several freshwater lakes, rivers which meet. And it's the Ramsar site, and it sustains about 2 lakh people. You know, there are about 200 islands within the lake. And each of them are fishing villages, and also do a little bit of farming inside. Then you have these dolphins and all. So next slide, please. This is, I also told about Asias. Then it is one of the most picturesque. Yeah, next slide. So it's a biodiversity hotspot like Bhitarkanika, as I said. Like there is a place called Mangalajiri, which is actually swamp on the outskirts. It's in the proximity of Chilka Lake, where you have such kind of grasslands, and which attracts thousands and millions of birds every year from as far as Siberia. So, and you can see from a very close proximity these birds. So this is how it is also a biodiversity hotspot. Yeah, next slide, please. So in the southern part, you have such the majestic hills of the Eastern Ghat, then you have the sprawling water, and then you have also the monuments, like some of the 18th century, 19th century colonial monuments you find. And give you a feel like that you are in the Mediterranean Sea. So, you know, so this is how the setting of Chilka Lake is. You are simply taken to somewhere like Greece or in the Mediterranean Sea. Then you have the Central Highland Odisha, which is actually from 900 meter to 1200 meter. You have majestic hills of the Eastern Ghat, densely covered. The Kandhamal district, especially Nayagarh and Kandhamal, which part of the Central Highland, you have 70 to 80% you have dense forest covered with. Then you have also amazing farming lands. So let's go to the next slide. Like you all know about Kerala, which has got Silence Valley. Here in Odisha, also at the Central Highland, you have a Silence Valley, which is a major watershed area, and at a height of 900 to 1200 meter. And you have so much of diversity of flora and fauna in this part of Odisha, and completely sands. And even if you are going in the monsoons, it is even more attractive. So next slide, please. Then you have the towering mountains of the Eastern Ghat. Then you have so many waterfalls, cascading waterfalls, all within this central part of Central Highland of Odisha. Yeah, next slide, please. Then you have the Sarkosya Gorge, which is part of not Central Highland, but it is in the periphery, where the Mahanadi River flows almost for 22 kilometers as a gorge. You know, in between you have the majestic hills of the Eastern Ghats and the Chotrang Plateau. It's again a biodiversity hotspot. It's also a tiger sanctuary, and besides, you have so many other animals. So it's one of the most beautiful sites in Odisha when it comes to here. And within these mountains of Central Highland Odisha, you have such tribal villages. You have years, thousands of years of old practices. And again, this is very, very different what you have in other parts of India, the experience. Yeah, next slide, please. Then you have the southern part of Odisha, bordering Andhra Pradesh and Chhattisgarh. You have the Koraput Plateau, where you have the tallest peak in Odisha, which goes up to 1680 meter is almost as high as Mount Abu in Rajasthan. and that's the mountain, and the whole area is filled with mountains. It's the actual Gondwana land, and where you have very, very ancient tribes, those who have been practicing. And you can see one woman here, she's from the Gadabat tribe, and these people have been living there for thousands of years, and they have amazing settlements, amazing stories to say. And then you have, yeah, next slide, please. Yes, next. So you have also some of the most dynamic, some of the most majestic waterfalls in the whole of South, in the whole of Indian subcontinent, you find here. So this is like the Durima waterfall, which is like almost, 900 feet. So they fall from the mountains, and surrounding these hills, you have the hamlets of the tribal communities. Yeah, next slide, please. Then you have such kind of rivers, which is actually like a fairy tale setting. So very, very, very interesting, you know. Then you have the Chotnak Plateau. Yeah, next slide, please. You have the Chotnak Plateau, where you have the Sinlipal biosphere. It's the major tiger sanctuary in Odisha. It's covered with dense forest and high mountains and waterfalls. And it's very difficult to sight tigers, of course, because of the dense forest. But it is like, for nature lovers, it is a paradise. You can just spend there. It's one of the most densest forests in the whole of India. Yeah, next slide, please. Then you have some of the oldest rock formations in the whole of the world in this part of Odisha. So the Jirkon, for example, 4.2 billion year old, is the rock. And this is the only of its kind in the whole world after Australia. So this is like the oldest rock formations, which date back to 4.2 billion at the time of the Earth's origin. So this is how is the geographical diversity of Chotnak Plateau. Then next slide, please. You have also very rich archaeological sites in this plateau, in these rock formations. Like, you know, must be knowing about Ajanta. Here, like, there's a place called Sitabirji, where you have also fresco paintings going back to the Gupta period, almost 1500 years. So this is again very known, and it's only of its kind the whole of Eastern and Northeastern India district. Then you have such amazing waterfalls again in the Chotnak Plateau. So it's all rich in waterfalls. And this is what I end my session. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jitu sir, for such a wonderful presentation and the wonders of Odisha. It was amazing to see, sir, that Odisha also has some Odisha rich of its cultural heritage, and apart from it, very rich in the geographical aspects also. It was nice to see you, and thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.
So coming to our next presenter, it's I am very glad to associate it with our next presenter. She is an inspiration to everybody. She is presenting our next presenter. She is Alia Sultana Babi. I welcome Miss Alia on board. Talking about her profile, she is an royal princess. She is a Nawabzadi of the erstwhile state of Balasinod from the Babi dynasty, and she is an paleontologist and a custodian and a guardian of the Balasinod, the famous Balasinod Fossil Park of Gujarat. I welcome you on board.
Thank you, Mr. Mathur. It's a pleasure being here. And I'm honored indeed to be speaking on this panel where a lot of the prominent and well-known people have spoken about. So can you start the slideshow, please?
Yeah, I am starting. Meanwhile, can you give a brief intro about yourself?
Yes. Hello, everyone. My name is Alia, and I'm fondly called Dr. Dinosaur or Princess Dinosaur because I've been associated with the fossil park at Balasinod in Gujarat for since the past 26 years. I have been associated with the park as a guardian, custodian, crusader. Someone who has tried to bring forth the dinosaur fossil park to the world, and as most of you must be aware that the dinosaur fossil park in Balasinod is one of its kind in the whole world, because the unique feature of our fossil park is that it is the hatchery as well as the graveyard. And in fact, in 1997, we had approximately 50 paleontologists, geologists and all who has visited us from all over the world. And they were the ones who said that this is probably one of the third largest hatchery in the world, after Aix-en-Provence in France, Mongolia. The dinosaur fossil park in Balasnor is the third. So we feature in the first three. So it indeed is a very proud moment for us. It's a very proud feeling for most of us to be featured in the first three when it comes to dinosaur fossils and dinosaur eggs. In fact, perhaps the most significant fossil discovery of the 20th century in India is that of the fossilized remains and the eggs. And these are the fossils which were discovered here. They belong to these two dinosaurs which are only from India. One of them is was named Rajasaurus Narmadensis, and the other was the Rayolisaurus Gujaratensis. So I very lovingly call them my Gujju dinosaurs. And it's a very proud feeling again indeed that these dinosaurs, the Gujju dinosaurs as I call them, they feature in the World Dictionary of Dinosaurs. Of course, not only Gujarat, but the whole of the Indian subcontinent had a lot of dinosaurs. And most of you have spoken on this topic about India. India has a lot of, you know, it has a lot of history. It has a lot of prehistoric history. It has, I mean, it plays such a significant role in so many aspects and all. And I'm a humble student of English literature. I'm not that great as most of you all who are probably all PhD holders and all. But because it was my interest and everything that I got involved with this, and whatever little I can contribute today, it'll be my pleasure to do so. So the first slide that we see is about the Balasnor Dinosaur Fossil Park, which is located in the small little village of Rayoli, in which is near Balasnor town. Now Balasnor is of course very closely connected to the national highway Ahmedabad to Indore. So we do have a very easy access now. And as you know, Ahmedabad is very well connected by flights and by trains also. So we have very easy access to Balasnor, and I've tried to create something called Dino Tourism. So we do get a lot of tourists over the years, of course, before the consequent lockdown. We've had a lot of tourists visiting our fossil park and museum to get to know more about the dinosaurs in India. So the second slide that you saw was of the Rajasaurus. Mr. Mathur, the slides are not visible. Can you do something about it?
Just a minute.
Hello?
Are they visible now?
Yeah, so that was the first one was the Rajasaurus. This is the Rayolisaurus. So, you know, the village of Rayoli where the site was, where the site is, it's called Rayoli, and we have a dinosaur which is named after the village of Rayoli. So it is called the Rayolisaurus Gujaratensis. And we can have the third one. This is the Titanosaurus. So the Titanosaur was also found in Rayoli, Balasnor. Of course, the Titanosaurus was also found all over India. This was, of course, a sauropod dinosaur, the one who was a vegetarian, who feasted on a lot of the grass and the leaves. The next slide, please. Another famous discovery from our region was the Sanaje Indicus. So, because as I mentioned earlier, our region is in the first three for dinosaur eggs. So, we found the paleontologists in the 1980s, they discovered a nest of dinosaur eggs, a sauropod nest. And when a lot of research took place, of course, with the GSI, and after that, this particular piece also traveled to the US, to the University of Chicago and Michigan. And when they did the research, and when it was announced to the world, they said that this was actually a snake which had coiled itself round the nest of dinosaur eggs, and it was about to pounce on the hatchling, that is the baby dinosaur. And at that moment, because dinosaurs generally used to lay the eggs near a water body. Mr. Mathur, the slides are not visible, please. It used to lay eggs near the water body, so probably there was some flooding and all. And the whole nest, along with the snake and the baby dinosaur, and the unhatched eggs all got washed away, and it got buried under a debris of rocks and soil and all. And over a period of time, it got preserved. Of course, after 65 million years, it got discovered by the GSI. And after a lot of research, they announced to the world. So this is, just imagine, a small little fossil, but it gives such a big story. It is actually a whole story in just a small little fossil, that how dinosaurs used to lay the eggs and how a snake just came and was about to eat it. But of course, the baby dinosaur didn't meet its death in that way. It met its death in another form. But this is a very, very unique representation. This is a very unique fossil for two reasons. Because when they found it, they the first slide that you see is actually the original fossil. It's a picture of the original fossil. So you can see two unhatched eggs. And on the left part, you can actually see the bones of the snake. You can see some parts of the snake. And the topmost corner, you can the topmost left-hand corner, you can actually see the jaw of the snake. And of course, the picture is a representation. This was actually, it's a picture which was prepared in the University of Chicago by one of the paleo artists who was involved with the research. And so it explains everything. You can even see the water as to how the nest is there, and you have the snake which was about to feast on it, and you had the water coming and, you know, washing away everything. So this is, in fact, one of the very good pieces or a very good example of how there was a non-dinosaurian predation on a dinosaur. And this is what was found from the Balasanaur region. And we can have this is a picture of our site where you can see. Of course, we're trying to make it a very tourist-friendly site. There are, as I mentioned, there are lots of fossil sites, excavation sites all across India. But I think we can say that our site at Balasanaur is one of the most tourist-friendly sites. We now have a fantastic museum by Gujarat Tourism there, which was inaugurated by our Honorable Chief Minister last year. And we've had more than 90,000 tourists who have visited our site in the past 6 months since its inauguration last year. These are some of the fossils that you get to see, which are from my collection. I have, as I mentioned, I'm a protector, guardian, custodian. So I have managed to rescue quite a lot of the fossils over a period of time. They've been lying scattered, they've been lying loose, they are broken away. We managed to collect some of them from the villagers also. And we've donated to the museum. I myself have donated a couple of fossils to the museum, and I've appealed to the villagers also to do so. So you get to see all that. These are some of the barricaded fossils that we've done, because you see, when tourists come to the site is the place where you see the fossilized remains of the dinosaurs in the natural form. So when one is ignorant, one tends to step over the fossils, and in that process, we tend to destroy it. So my main aim was to protect these fossils, and that is what we managed to do with the help of the various departments of the government. And we barricaded all the individual fossils. Of course, the whole area, which is approximately 72 hectares, which is what we call the fossil park, has also been barricaded now. It is protected under the Bombay Protection Act. So these are some of the fossils. We can see the next slide, please. What you see here is actually the nests. These are the egg nests. So these egg nests are also all spread across 72 hectares. But there's this one particular area in the 72 hectares, which is just dedicated to the eggs. So you don't find a single bone over there. You will only find eggs there. So that was probably the nesting grounds. So probably that area 65 million years ago was a good area for them. It was a secure, protected, safe environment for these dinosaurs to go and lay the eggs there. So probably that was what we call communal breeding grounds for the dinosaurs, that most of the dinosaurs used to go and lay the eggs there. So you can see the egg rings in the second picture that was there. If you see closely, you can see two of the eggs and in close proximity. So these are what we call clusters or a clutch, and they would consist of probably 5 to 7 eggs or 15 to 20 eggs, depending on what type of a dinosaur was laying them. The second slide, please. Yeah, so this is what you can see is actually one of the bones in the natural form. This is one of the it's a thigh bone, and the second one is also a bone. So these are the two different types of bones that as a tourist you will get to see in the natural form at the fossil park. Of course, as a layman you will not be able to identify much. Everything will look like rocks to you, so you definitely need to take the help of the me or the 2-3 guides that we have managed to employ there at the fossil park. So these are some of the slides that we showed to you explaining about the dinosaur fossil park in Balasinore and why it is visited by so many tourists. Because in today's day and time, you see a lot of children as well as a couple of adults too. They all are fascinated by the world of dinosaurs. Especially after the movies, you know, everyone is so fascinated by them. And this is something that I have tried over the years to create, which is called Dino Tourism. And through this mediums, we try to promote our fossil park and museum. So we hope to see more people there after the lockdown.
Thank you, Ms. Alia, for such a wonderful presentation on dino tourism and telling people about the fossils and the dinosaurs available in your Balasinore area. And it was, you created a new form of tourism that is known as the dino tourism in the tourism industry. We are very thankful for this wonderful initiative you have taken.
Thank you so much, Mr. Once again for giving me this opportunity.
Coming on to our next and the final presenter, we have a very own assistant professor who I say my mentor or my guide, who is guiding me from n number of years, and I must say that it is all due to her support. I welcome on board Dr. Avita Khawas. Please unmute yourself, ma'am.
Yeah. Namaskar, everyone.
So talking just a bio about I cannot say a lot about her because she is my mentor, she is my guide. But just whatever she has told and whatever I have received from her, I'm just telling about it. Dr. Avita Khawas is a PhD in heritage tourism and she is a double master's in tourism and human resource management, and she is currently working as an assistant professor in the Department of Hotel Management and Tourism in Punjab. Apart from the academic, she is also working as the director of Walk Around India. So what is Walk Around India? Walk Around India is she is creating different various types of walks in and around the Indian subcontinent. I am very fortunate to associate with her because obviously all the things which we are doing in association with her and the under guidance of Dr. Avita. Welcome you on board, Dr. Avita.
Thank you, Gunjan, for such kind words and motivating words. In fact, each day we are learning from each other. And, you know, I think this is one of the most best presentations I have been part of in Geo Heritage. And, you know, geo tourism is something that we wanted to work upon for a longer time. So before starting the presentation, I'm extremely thankful for Mr. Mathur and your son, and Mr. Ranawat and Mr. Jeetu Mishra, and if Ms. Alia ma'am is also here. It is extremely wonderful to hear from you all that what all is geo heritage, how we can promote it, and you know the basics of it. So if you talk about the technicalities of all these things, I may be a little immature in that because my work is to, you know, the promote tourism and bring tourists to all those sites and all. So I'll be talking about that. I'll make it a little crisp and to the time that the geo-heritage sites of Shivalik Belt, which basically includes Punjab, Haryana and Himachal, because this all covers in one zone. And how to promote it. You know, we have lots of geological sites, and Mr. Ranawat has also said that internationally, if you talk about, we have 161 geo-national parks, and if you talk about India, we have none. And talking about none and the other things is a very different aspect, but the awareness, if you talk about that, people didn't know much about what the geo-heritage and geo-parks are. So I would be talking a little bit about that. So my topic would be Geoheritage Sites of India. So I think this is not good to say, talk about the definition, that the terms from the basic definition, but as I can see, there are lots of students up here and they are messaging me to just come up with the basic definition. So I'll just read it out. The derivation of the term geoheritage is from geological heritage. It is thus a heritage category comparable to the forms of natural heritage such as biodiversity. Some geoheritage sites or geosites are related to human activities such as mining or can be viewed in terms of a cultural heritage. So that's the basic definition. And yeah, this is the point that I would like to cover, that geodiversity of India is varied as most other aspects of the country, with landscape changing from the world's greatest peaks to the coastal dunes, large inland water bodies at the same time as wetlands, coral reef islands, and in a number of places we find a variety of rocks and minerals and distinctive fossil assemblies. These geological features and landscapes that evolved over billions of years tells us spectacular stories of our origins, and India's tumultuous geological past is recorded in its rocks and terrains, and they should be considered our non-cultural heritage. So I consider everything as the non-cultural heritage. And if we compare to geoheritage sites, which is there in many countries and developed as geoparks like Canada, China, Spain, US, UK, they have suitable provisions for preservation and conservation for their national geoheritage. And UNESCO has also prepared guidelines for the development of geoparks. Many countries have necessary legislation to build, protect and designate geoparks, and Europe itself has 73 zones. But if we talk about India, we didn't have one good geopark, we can say that, which we can visit and which we can promote it up. Yeah, next please. So I'll be talking about the geological and geomography of Mesopalatial and archaeological site in Chandigarh, which is commonly called the Shivalik Frontal Range of the northwestern India. Gunjan, we can skip this slide because already the experts are there and we have talked more about that. So I'll just brief upon what we have here in Chandigarh and around region and what we are doing to promote it. So this is one of the pictures which you can see outside the Chandigarh Natural History Museum. And not only this is the museum area, and in the museum area there are lots of rocks being put up. It's not inside the museum, but it is outside the museum, and these are all the rocks of the importance of geoheritage. And if you can see, the person here is Mr. Arya. So we conduct the walks with the expert. Here we have conducted one such walk last year to celebrate the geoheritage here, and the kids and everyone being taken along, and they were being told about the importance of each and every rock there. And here also, in each of the roundabouts, if you see in Chandigarh and Panchkula and many other areas, you'll see that each and every roundabout, few of the roundabouts has these rocks set up as the central piece. So if you have been to a museum and you know a bit about these rocks, that if it is a red sandstone, it is a black sandstone, or some other kind of rocks, then you can know more about it, and you can have an obvious curiosity that why these rocks are here in the central plaza or the roundabouts. So that is one of the way that we are trying to promote, or in fact the planners of the Chandigarh had promoted the geoheritage long years back. So this is also one of the pictures of the rocks being laid in the straight manner, the various types that you can see outside the Natural History Museum, and we have conducted a walk over here. And this is the last year picture, and we have planned lots of other activities this year. But yeah, the COVID has taken up this year. But no issues, we are doing very well online as well. So this is the way we conduct small walks to encourage people about what you know, the geo heritage is, and it is the recently taken up initiative by Walk Around India and Travelostan, and we are deeply into it to promote it. Yeah, will the next slide, please. Now I'll be talking about the Shivalik Fossil Park over here, which is also known as the Sukerti Fossil Park, and it is the notified National Geo Heritage Monument Fossil Park in the Sirmaur district in the Indian state of Himachal Pradesh. And it has a collection of prehistoric vertebrate fossils and skeletons recovered from the upper and middle Shivalik geological formations of sandstones and clay at the Sukerti. And the park has a display of the fossils and finds and an open-air exhibition of 6 life-sized fiberglass models of extinct mammals in the creation of Shivalik Hills. So you can see a few of the animals here. And there is a museum within this premises of the park curated and exhibits the fossils. And Shivalik is the Asia's biggest fossil park, and the exhibit in the park are used to generate scientific interest among the public and facilitate the special international students by visiting, and a number of research scholars are also visiting, and we are also trying to promote in a way by bringing more tourists to it and kind of creating an awareness among the kids. So here you can see a few of the fiberglass fossils over here being designed. Yeah, next please. This is also about an extinct elephant. And all the details and everything is given of the vertebrates. Yeah, next please, Gunjan. This is 4-horned giraffe. Yeah, next please, Gunjan. Yeah, next slide, please. So that is all what we have here in Chandigarh. If we talk about the Tri-City area and the Himachal region, so I'll not talk about the technical detailities of what's been the geo-heritage site, but yeah, I'll be focusing more on that. Yes, these are the two places, and that is how the Chandigarh and the Himachal Pradesh are promoting the geo-heritage sites. And we are definitely working on how to promote it more, because the major problem we have is that the awareness, that people didn't have much of the awareness about these sites, and kids are very, very fascinated about, you know, the types of rocks we have, the different kind of structure they want to know. And in fact, we have we prepared one presentation of lots of pictures of geo places in an area, but I think because of some technical issues we are not able to present it up here, but someday we will do it in some another session.
Thank you, Dr. Amita, for the wonderful presentation about the Shivalik range. We heard about the Shivalik range in our school, and we never knew that this belt was so rich in the geographical area and geographical aspect. Thank you for giving an aspect about the geotourism in the sector of Shivalik range. Now we'll ask that the panelists to share, just give a brief about whatever we spoke about it, and request the audience to just pour in your questions so that we can take some questions. Over to you, Professor S.C. Mathur.
We have the wide spectrum of the geo-heritage of India, from east to north to west, and also fascinating talk of Alia Madam and Avita Madam, Mishra Sahib, and about the Mewar region by Kalos. So, in Indian context, we the panelists here should think about how to recognize, characterize, identify the geosites. Maybe we are talking about our region and the geosite of our region, but in a combined form, we should help evolve a methodology. We have published a paper I have mentioned in my talk. We should improve that methodology, considering the geodiversity of India, because we know that it is a very diverse topography and the physiography of India. So all aspects, we have to combine them, and legislation, Conservation Act, these are the, I should say that the birth of these laws and rules and regulation in India is actually a demand of the present time, and we should think about each, all the experts, the students, academicians, and the scientists should think over this. This is my message for today. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for a wonderful message to the presenters and the panelists. Now I'll request Professor Ranawat to give you closing words.
It was indeed a very refreshing and knowledgeable interaction. I'm grateful to all of you. I would just like to share one or two things that are always troubling me. I don't know why GSI, which used to declare National Geological Monument so easily earlier, now they have become so bureaucratic and just they don't want to do it. And we have very good sites, very good aspects are there, and people are after it, and we know things like Zawar, Ramgarh, they are not there. And they have recently sent to ONGC people when they wanted a National Geological Monument. So fortunately that letter has come to us also. They have given 8 aspects. Okay, you fulfill these aspects, then only we'll look forward to what can be done. So unfortunately, that is the reason why China has so many global geoparks and we don't have it. We should also go in what China and Italy are doing, or European countries are doing. We should classify regional geoheritage sites or geoparks, national geoparks, and international global geoparks. That sort of a classification will fulfill all the aspects. So I think that aspect can also be taken up. I saw in some of the things now geoheritage has been accepted as a single word. So there is no need for a dash, geo-heritage. We should go in for a one word, geotourism, geoheritage, geodiversity, and all these. And small publications or folders that I had shown, I showed you only one, but we have published tens of these heritage walk brochures. For every heritage walk or visits, we provide each of the people with a 2-page or 4-page folder, so that they are familiar, and we distribute it to the local tourism society also. They have an association of tourist guides or destination managers that they call these days. So they should be familiar with them. Our idea should be that we should have these information at people level, and not what we were sort of sitting in ivory towers doing things of art. It should be a public affair. People should be made. So, for example, biological aspects are there. Natural heritage sites are there in UNESCO World Heritage Sites, but not geological. They are all biological, because biologists have always gone ahead. They were one step ahead of the geologists. That's why they popularized the thing, and it is time that we should realize these things. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful information and the insight about it. I would like Mr. Jitu Mishra to conclude your session. Please unmute yourself once.
It was indeed a great pleasure to hear all of you, because I think India has amazing geoheritage sites. Northeast is full of it, actually. And then you have in Chhattisgarh, Kutumsarke, for example. So there are so many sites, and they some of these sites are also like the natural rock centers where early humans, you know, had lived. For example, Bhimbetka, and then there are several sites in Madhya Pradesh you will find in the whole of Vidyas. So more and more stories have to be created, I think, curated and brought into the notice of travelers, students, school students and college students, so that, you know, in the due process, they get recognized. And once people start engaging with these sites, I think then government or any authority will start taking them seriously, because once there is a demand created, and this demand has to be created from our side, and that is done, I think that is how the tourism will grow. Otherwise, simply asking government, because when we talk about the government, you know, they would not know about the potential. They would not have that kind of emotions what we have. So, you know, this is how I think we'll have to try and do more and more. And such seminars and webinars will open up, you know, more understanding about the richness and the, you know, the geodiversity or geoheritage in the country. And more regions should be brought into light. So that is what is my request to Mr. Mathur, and probably we will do it more. And thank you. This is what is my take. And all, I think all the presentations were excellent. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jitu sir, for wonderful words. Now would I request Ms. Alia Babi for the concluding words. Hello. Dr. Avita, can you please conclude the session?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, Gunjan. So before, I would like to conclude that this is going to be just the beginning of the first session in knowing about the geoheritage sites of India. And I am very, very grateful to all the speakers, and I would like to make sure that we have another session. Gunjan, with your permission, I would like to say that we can plan one more session, and we would like to try to involve more of the audience into it and in knowing the geoheritage places in India.
So definitely, with due permission from Professor S.C. Mathur and Ranawat sir, we'll definitely plan something, the second episode of it.
Yeah. So in the end, I am extremely grateful to Mr. S.C. Mathur sir for your detailed presentation of the Marwar geoheritage sites and what all the region is doing. And being a Marwari by itself, it gives us immense proud to know your state and region better. And also we are very grateful to Mr. Ranawat sir for showing the detailed description about Udaipur and the potential more Udaipur can bring besides from the heritage part and the, you know, the culture part. It's the geoheritage thing which can be promoted. Definitely we will work on it to make sure that it comes in the limelight, because unless and until it's not being worked out, it's null and void. So we'll make sure that we do something to promote it and to make sure that it is there in the frontier when we talk about the Rajasthan tourism. I'm extremely thankful to Mr. Jitu Mishra sir as well. So we loved your presentation. In fact, everybody's presentation is very good. But you know, the pictorial things and the kind of the unexplored part which Odisha has, and Odisha always has been an unexplored destination when it comes to tourism in India. So we will definitely note your points, and I have noted many of your points, and we'll try to promote it, and we'll see what best we can do in terms of again bringing more tourism to the state and how we can relate it all together. And I'm also very thankful to Ms. Alia Bala Sinor ma'am for her exquisite details about what she's actually doing on grounds and how she's preserving the fossil park and promoting it on the tourism front line. So it was indeed a wonderful, wonderful session, and there are lots of questions being asked that why government is not doing anything in order to promote the tourism in Sutch site. So I think the question is open to you all, and we'll someday try to work out to promote in a more particular way. And we have more geo parks over here in India as well. Because to my knowledge, there the Grand Canyon is there, Chichen Itza is there, and these are the world most visited, fossil parks or the geo heritage places are there. So I think India is also there in the list, and we have to work out together. And not last but not the least, thank you, Gunjan, for coming up with such a beautiful presentation and tying the thread of this beautiful garland from, from north to south, from east to west. All the speakers were brilliant, brilliant. And we are very thankful for you to also to offer organizing this kind of seminar. And this is not just the end. So I'm extremely thankful for everyone and the audience who have joined us and be patient with us and have asked lots of questions. Thank you everyone for joining us, and keep asking the questions in whatever ways we are able to promote tourism, to bring more employment. Basically, we would be grateful for that. So thank you everyone. Thank you. If you have thank any you. Questions, anyone, can you
one question, we can take me? One question, like as you said that what is the tourism industry, what is the industry and the commissions are doing along with government developing geo heritage sites. Over to you, panelists. Anybody from the panelists can answer this.
Please repeat the question.
What kind of efforts industry or academicians are doing for convincing government for developing geo tourism sites?
Actually, industry has its social responsibility fund, and they can be approached to invest in these things. That has to go, because we have to educate people a lot. People are just unaware of these things. Even industry is not aware of it. Fortunately, in Udaipur, we have an example. Hindustan Zinc is there, RSMML is there. Some good industries are there. We can approach them, and they can definitely develop in promoting these geo heritage sites. Even tourism industry can come up with. But academicians should now not publish academic papers. They are gone. They are all saturated. This is what I say. Tatva tatva sura kahi, tulsi kahi anuti. Now people are just repeating jhooti baat wo ka wo bol rahe hain. हमें नई चीज़ चाहिए और नई पब्लिक के लिए चाहिए. उसके लिए जो ऐसे छोटे टू पेज पैम्पलेट्स हैं, ऐसे जब तक आप बना के इफ़ यू डोंट गिव इट टू द पब्लिक और द पीपल, दे विल नॉट अंडरस्टैंड दीज थिंग्स. एंड वेरी गुड साइनेजेस हैव टू कम. फॉर एग्जांपल, व्हेन वी अरेंज हेरिटेज साइट्स, इट फॉल्स इन टू फॉरेस्ट डिपार्टमेंट. सो वी अप्रूव्ड ACF and DCF, and they will readily put up signages, and whatever we suggested, they sort of cooperated with us. Some fund was provided by INTAC, some fund was provided by University Geology Department, just about 5 to 10,000 rupees. And for example, last year we organized, Professor Mathur knows, they organized in Jaipur, Jodhpur, we did it in Udaipur, involved school students also for 21st July, first heritage aspect. So the industry can easily be brought in. And what is the good is, not many people are not aware. We have approached MP and MLA. Okay, why don't you adapt Zawar? Why don't you adopt Zawar Kotra? So likewise, all the MLAs and MPs throughout India, if they can adopt one or two good sites, that will make a fantastic thing. Most of that fund is going unutilized. Every MP and MLA has a lot of fund with them. So funding is no problem. Then there is unfortunately that part is not covered. We are making efforts to include. There is a district mineral development trust. 10% of the royalty of a district goes to this trust. And collector is in charge of that. So Hindustan Zinc, RSMM, they are praying in crores of rupees. So as of now, say about at least 1,000 crore rupees are available to district magistrate of Udaipur to develop the things, infrastructure. That could also be utilized. So funds are there. Only thing is awareness is not there. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful... Thank you, sir, for answering the question. One more question is there from Mr. B.L. Vishnuin. He wants to ask how conservation of traditional water bodies is important to preserve geo-heritage and what is the role of government can play in this regard? S.C. Mathur, sir. Sir, unmute kar le apne aapko. Jitu sir,
Ranawat
sir, anybody can answer this question?
Yes, yes. I am going to answer this.
Okay, sir.
Now, all the water bodies comes in the category of hydrogeotourism or hydrogeoheritage sites. As far as the conservation of these water, ancient water bodies is concerned, the last government before this Vasundhara Raje, under the CMC of Vasundhara Raje, there was a scheme of the state government, Jal Swavalamban. Under that scheme, as far as my knowledge or my information is concerned, more than 2,000 water structures have been renovated. And in particular in the Jodhpur, about 52 water bodies. Most of them are the Jharva and Bauri have been conserved and renovated under this scheme. So government is also paying attention towards conservation of these. But what Ranaut sir is suggesting is most, but before conserving any site or any geoheritage site, we need to assess and identify the geosite as for the standard of international standard and whatever the methodology is there, we have to study there. First, we have to establish the international significance or national significance of the particular geosite. So we have to develop the inventory, methodology, and then come to the conservation plan. Why we don't have any geopark in India? Because we don't have any infrastructure regarding these issues. So first, as Anasav suggests that we have to aware the public, we have to aware the politician, we have to aware the bureaucrat regarding our subject first. So for the subject awareness, it needs the detailed study of the geosites. And we should publish some papers to research on these particular sites to establish their national and international significance, then we can think for the geopark internationally, the UNESCO Global Geopark. But before that, as Professor Ranaut has suggested that we should go for the national geopark tag, the regional geopark tag, so under which program the state government and central government can integrate all these sites and promote the study of these sites and can provide the tag. So myself and Ranaut Sahab and many other fellow, they have written the potential geopark of particular area. We have proposed for Jodhpur, Ajmer and Jaipur. Ranaut Sahab has proposed for Udaipur, Ramgarh Crater, Jawar. So these studies, we have to involve so many scientists with us. They can study their particular area and the geosites. Then the documents will come to the international level and national level. Then we can create the pressure to the politicians and the bureaucrats. So this is my suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful information and answering the question. I think so. India is working towards developing of geoparks, and I must thank Professor S.C. Mathur and Ranawat sir they are in the core members of in the team, and they are proposing the government for making geoparks in the country. And with this, we are very thankful to all our panelists, Professor Ranawat, Professor S.C. Mathur, Saurabh Mathur, Mrs. Alia, Jitu Mishra sir, and Dr. Avita Khawas for sparing a Sunday valuable time with us. And I must say that we planned a session for 1 hour, and the session is for 1 hour 45 minutes. And we are very thankful to all our audience for listening to us. I was thinking, हम लोग सोच रहे थे कि यार एक घंटे का सेशन रहेगा, क्या क्या बोलेंगे, क्या क्या नहीं बोलेंगे और कौन सुनेगा. But after seeing your comments and after seeing your questions, I feel proud, and on behalf of all the panelists, we feel proud that we have school students from class 10th and 11th who are pouring questions. And this is a very good sight of that people are taking interest in especially the geography or the geotourism in this. So I must thank all the panelists for sparing such a time, and thank you all the audience for listening to us. Thank you. And this session we'll upload it on YouTube and share the link with you. Thank you all of you. Have a great day and good night.